Hi everybody, how are you? So today I wanted to talk more about error handling in Go. It's one of the most common complaints I hear about the language, and to me, it just comes from a sort of misunderstanding of the application of error handling in the language. So I figured I would give you a bit of an example of something that I thought was kind of interesting and would possibly be a better way of doing things. In particular, how do you handle dynamic errors, right? Like that's a problem as well, right? So let's talk a little bit more about like what is an error in Go. So an error is just an interface, right? So if I wanted to come in here and I wanted to declare like a custom error, I could say type my error struct, right? Just give it like a blank struct, and then I can have a pointer receiver that takes a my error, call it an error, return some kind of string, and I could say return, you know, my error. Nothing crazy there, right? Heck, let's even take it a step further. Let's say I type this error. Let's make that a blank struct. But let's give this some kind of like data associated with it. So let's just call it data. Let's say JSON dot like a raw message. JSON raw messages are literally type alias. It's just a type alias for a byte slice in Go. It's just like any is an alias for interface. It's the exact same thing. Just treat it like that. So let's do the same thing over again. Let's put this here. But let's do this again for this error. So type, so let's do func, forgot to do n, func t, this error, it's an error, returns a string, and let's return, this error. Okay, cool. So now we have declared these like custom errors. How are we going to deal with them? So I'm just going to give you an example of like, let's say, let's just say that we want to handle some kind of error upon insert, right? So here's my insert function. I want to be able to insert an error. Like, let's say that there's some kind of error in here where we're not able to insert or whatever. It doesn't really matter, right? So let's take a look at this. So let's say new error. Let's say it's a my error. Okay, we instantiate our like error object. Let's say that the insert fails in some reason, but we still want to log what data was associated with that. We would say new error.data is equal to message. Remember, I'm using my WebSockets library as an example. Go watch my WebSocket thing if you're kind of wondering what I'm working on here or whatever. Cool. But the problem is here is that this is like, it's a concurrent function. I don't want to return an error from one of these handlers, right? Or excuse me, this is an HTTP handler function. I don't really want to return an error because then it screws with like the interface. So what do you do then? Well, this is a design pattern that you can follow for basically like any Go routines, right? And you can have essentially like channels. So let's take a look at our database object. So our database object is a map, a string of byte slices, right? Let's add an error chan on top of it. So chan error. So anything that satisfies the error interface is going to be able to be placed upon this channel. So then let's make, let's just call it EC, right? So EC is equal to make a chan error. All right, cool. So then it's not being used, so let's call it error chan. We're going to call it EC. Okay, cool. So now we have this function that's or this data structure that has an error channel associated with it. So if you can look, right? I have a connection. It's a pointer receiver to the cache that this function operates upon, right? Cool. Well, let's write a Go routine that will handle these errors, right? So let's say func, error monitor, right? And let's say it operates on a chain error. Or maybe like a better way of doing it would probably be like C pointer to cache dot error chan, maybe something like that. I'm just going to stick with this for now. It doesn't really matter. You understand what I'm trying to get at. So let's go in here and deal with this. Well, let's go down here first and say like go error monitor and hand it EC. So now we're gonna have a Go routine that's running and it's monitoring this error channel, right? And we've instantiated that. That's the same error channel that's in our cache structure. So we're gonna go to error monitor. We're saying we have an error channel. So the way to do this is a for switch. So we're gonna say for this function, right? We're gonna switch on the error. We're gonna make it non-blocking. So we're gonna, every time an error comes across the channel, we're gonna make a copy of it, which is basically like plucking it off of the channel. And so it's not blocking. And let's come in here and say on E, and I'm going to switch on the error.type. So, whoa, what is that? What's going on here, right? What are we doing? So this is just a very terse way of saying, hey, create a switch, pluck the error off of the channel, or I mean, it's any object channel, whatever. In this case, it's errors. Pluck it off and test what type it is. What type are we talking about, right? So it's essentially like a type assertion type conversion kind of thing, a way of doing things, but it's kind of a way of basically doing an enumeration without doing an enumeration. So let's say we have a case of my error, right? So let's come in here and say fmt.print line. First off, let's say that we have a my error, right? So a my error has some data associated with it. This error doesn't. So then technically they both satisfy the error interface, but the underlying object is actually quite different. Okay, so let's try to garner that error. And we're just gonna do basically like a type conversion. That's all we're gonna do. So I wanna grab that underlying error. So we're gonna say fmt.print line my error, right? And I wanna do something with the underlying data structure, the underlying like data of a my error. Well, we've already asserted that it's a my error type. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here in the switch statement. So let's do this. It's gonna look crazy. Trust me, it's not crazy. We're gonna have a string because remember the underlying data is of type json.raw message, which is a type alias for a byte slice. So you gotta convert it to a string. And then we're going to do a type conversion. And we're gonna convert it into a my error. So we're gonna say error.convert it to a my error. And then we're gonna grab its data. Bam. But let's say that, oh, hey, this case is, well, now it's, now it's a, what is it? It's a pointer to a this error. Well, I don't really want to do anything. I just want to do an fmt.println, this error. Excuse me. There we go. And then also let's do, like, what happens if it's undefined? Right? What happens if we get an error, but it's of neither of these types? that's undefined. So we just come in here and say like a default. Default fmt.println, you know, undefined error. It's not going to be in this case because we're just having fun, essentially, right? So yeah, that's literally how you can do this. Now the question is going to be like, of course, well, I have a storable interface, right? That's, you know, I have three or four different types of errors that can come off of trying to insert into a database, right? The database connection's closed. I can't get something from the pool. The connection times out, or the request times out, blah, 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 right? I can't return an error from that. In fact, my interfaces are really well defined. Like, I can't instantiate more objects from that. I don't want to import the database package itself is essentially what you're trying to say. Well, there is no reason why you can't have an errors package, right? In fact, that's exactly what I would suggest. And then that errors package is imported by both libraries, in this case, like the DB library or the cache library, and then the other one being the other, you know, whatever library is like calling the database interface. And then you're not having any kind of cyclical imports. So let's see if this runs. Okay, so it's up and running. So we're in here. So go run main.go. Let's see if this inserts. Cool. Okay, so it's inserting. Awesome. So let's go and look at our error. So if it's not found, okay, cool. So this was why. I'm being silly right now. I wasn't passing it over the error channel. So let's come down here, and now we can see kind of what this looks like when we do return these errors. So let's say c.errorchan, and let's pass it, this error over this errorchan and kind of see what happens, right? So here you can see all of a sudden, it's pumping out of my error, right? And then it's telling me exactly what is contained within that object. So this is a pattern that I find really handy and really useful, especially like, let's say that you have a certain type of error, like a JSON unmarshaled error, right? So you get a bunch of bytes over some kind of connection, HTTP, you know, gRPC, or you get something over a REST endpoint, or you get something over a WebSocket. And you have some kind of marshaling error associated with it, but you don't really understand what it is, you want to be able to cache that byte slice. And so a really good way of doing this is saying, oh, hey, like if there is an error associated with this here, where I cannot unmarshal this byte slice, I want to take that set of data, I want to dump it onto Redis is a very common application of this sort of thing. And you know, from there, I can come back later and I can try to parse this. So there's all different kinds of ways that you can use this design pattern, but I'm tired of the complaints where people are saying like Go's error handling is verbose. It's not verbose if you apply the tools and sort of do, especially when it comes to like concurrent functions, it can seem really verbose, but it probably just means you're not doing it right, or you're not, you know, you're not applying the tools that you can apply to it. So that's my rant about Go error handling and a fun little design pattern for like dealing with Go's error handling. So thanks a bunch. Have a good one.